Hey everybody, welcome to Timbridge Church's online campus. We are so glad that you are here today. My name's Nick and my wife Johanna and I are the lead pastors here at Timbridge, and we're so excited that you've made the decision to join us for worship today. If you live here locally in the Stephenville area, we want you to be able to save the date for a couple upcoming outdoor events we're hosting for our entire church. The first one is Wednesday night, August 5th. We're hosting a family fun picnic right here on the lawn at Timbridge. It's bring your own food, and we'll have a fun night of picnic, games, family fun, safe distancing style. The second one is Sunday, August 16th. We're hosting an outdoor night of worship where we'll worship together, celebrate baptism, and pray for the new school year. It's a night you won't want to miss. We'll be sharing more details about both of these upcoming events in the days to come, but be sure to mark your calendars now. And if you're ready to go public with your faith in Jesus and to put on the jersey of Team Jesus through baptism, be sure to go to timbridgechurch.com/baptism and sign up today. As we get rolling today, I also wanted to thank those of you who continue to generously give to the ministry of Timbridge Church. In fact, this week we were able to bless our friends and neighbors with a pizza and movie night because of your generosity. It's a small way to bring some positive smiles to the faces of our neighbors during these trying days. So thank you to every single one of you who is contributing to our ministry through your generous giving. Together, we're making a real impact in the lives of our friends and neighbors. If you'd like to contribute and be a part of our offering today, you can do so in a few different ways. You can give online at timbridgechurch.com/give. You can give via text by texting any amount to 84321, or you can give via the Venmo app at Timbridge Church. Again, thank you for your generosity. It's making a difference locally and globally for the cause of Jesus. We're pumped to have you worshiping with us today. Pastor Johanna's continuing our Wise Up series this morning with a message that will bless us. So let's lean in together and connect with Jesus today. Here we go.
He has has overcome, let all the earth, every tribe and tongue, we will sing it out. He has overcome. We will shout it out from the mountain tops that our God is good. He has overcome. Let all the earth, every tribe and tongue, we will sing it out. He has
I'm gonna see. and welcome to Timbridge Church Online. I am Johanna Burleson, and along with my husband, Nick, we lead and pastor Timbridge Church. We're in week three of a series called Wise Up. Wise Up. It's a series on the study of the book of Proverbs in the Bible. Proverbs is full of wisdom on how to live, and we've been diving in to see what it looks like to live with wisdom. But lately, I have been fascinated with foolishness. Yes, foolishness. I know it seems silly, but as we've studied wisdom in the last few weeks and how wisdom talks and how to make wise decisions, those are the last few messages, the opposite has intrigued me. That if wisdom looks one way, well, what does foolishness look like? If the wise live one way, what does it look like to live like a fool? And how many times in life can we be the fool? I've been the fool. I've been foolish. I didn't listen to the voice of wisdom. And we can all agree that we have taken the same path, the path of foolishness. There's the path of foolishness versus the path of wisdom. And as Pastor Nick said a few weeks ago, knowledge and wisdom are not the same thing. Yes, get knowledge, learn, and get an education. But knowledge isn't the answer. We are by far the most educated culture, but we're collapsing. We're drowning in data, but wisdom is waning because wisdom comes from God. Knowledge is something you gain, but wisdom is something you receive. Knowledge is in the head, but wisdom, it's in the heart. Knowledge teaches you, wisdom transforms you. And if you aren't wise, then you're a fool. If you don't have wisdom, then you are foolish. And truthfully, the foolish path is where we naturally end up. We drift into foolishness naturally, living like a fool. Fool. The Bible describes a fool as someone who doesn't necessarily lack mental powers, but as someone who misuses them, someone who misuses their mental capacity, the things that they know, someone who is open. The Hebrew word used in Scripture to describe a fool literally means open, open to anything, open to everything. A fool is someone who is open, someone who is flying by the seat of their pants, doing whatever they want. I'm foolish when I do what makes me feel good, what makes me look good, whatever puts the wind in my sails, saying whatever I want to say, choosing what I want to choose. Living like that, it's away from God. It's keeping him at arm's length. And living like that will lead you down the foolish path. And then you begin to live like a fool. So how do you live like a fool? I've got three ways to help you know if you're living like a fool. And the first way is this. Refuse criticism. If you want to live like a fool, you will refuse criticism. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7, fear of the Lord is the foundation of true knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and discipline. Fools, they don't want to hear wisdom. They don't want to be corrected. They don't want to be criticized. Proverbs 29:1, whoever stubbornly refuses to accept criticism will suddenly be destroyed beyond recovery. Proverbs 13:18, if you ignore criticism, you will end in poverty and disgrace. If you accept correction, you'll be honored. Proverbs 15:32, if you reject discipline, you only harm yourself. But if you listen to correction, you grow in understanding. Can we all agree? Most of us don't like criticism or correction. We have an adverse reaction to being corrected. What is your reaction when you're criticized? This one's a hard one for me. Honestly, I personally struggle with criticism. My first reaction is to be defensive because if I'm being corrected, then I perceive that I have done something wrong or bad. And then my brain immediately jumps to that I'm a bad person. Has that ever happened to you? Where a correction, it feels like a personal attack, which then leads to feeling shame and personal humiliation. So for me, it's a constant education to retrain my brain that regardless of the person's intent, whether it was to harm me or to bring me good, I can find something to learn from the correction, to learn from the criticism. I'm not a bad person. I'm not flawed beyond repair. I don't have to feel the shame, but I can learn from criticism. I can grow from it. If I want to be more like Jesus, then I can choose to see where I can grow versus objecting and being offended by criticism. Sometimes it takes me a few moments. Often it might take me a day or a few days, but I don't want to live like a fool. To live like a fool means to refuse criticism. Number two, to live like a fool, be impulsive. to live like a fool, then you're impulsive. Proverbs 29:11. Fools vent their anger, but the wise quietly hold it back. Proverbs 14:16. The wise are cautious and avoid danger. Fools plunge ahead with reckless confidence. Fools act on their feelings. They're impulsive. They have to have immediate gratification. Now, over waiting, doing what they feel over what may be wise. Foolishness over wisdom. Let's all agree that our knee-jerk reactions probably aren't aligned with godly ones, that what we immediately feel, think, or say probably isn't taking the path of wisdom, but more likely taking the path of foolishness. That at the very basis of our being, we are human and flawed, and we think about ourselves, we think of ourselves, we think for ourselves over anything else. Proverbs 21:20 says, "The wise have wealth and luxury, but fools spend whatever they get." There's no self-control to think before they do. This is how a fool lives. And sometimes it isn't just our reactions to things, but even just an absence of action that is foolish. Impulsively, we want to do the thing that makes us feel good, which might mean to do nothing. Nothing. The book of Proverbs is loaded with verses about the fool is also someone who is lazy, slothful, and a sluggard. Proverbs 10:4, lazy people are soon poor, hard workers get rich. Proverbs 21:25, despite their desires, the lazy will come to ruin, for their hands refuse to work. Live with impulsivity, and you live like a fool, and ruin will come to your life. And lastly, a fool thinks they know better. Fools think they know better. Proverbs 12:15. Fools think their own way is right, but the wise listen to others. Proverbs 28:26. Those who trust their own insight are foolish, but anyone who walks in wisdom is safe. Proverbs 18:2. Fools have no interest in understanding. They only want to air their opinions. A fool thinks they know it all. They have the answers. They know the way. The choices to make, who to vote for, how to solve the problems and the world, they know. Their opinion is best. Their opinion is right. There's no other way. They just want to vent their frustrations. They want to say their piece. And they definitely don't want to listen because they know better. Raise your hand if you have ever been there, that you just want to be heard. Your opinion matters. You know the way, the right way. Raise your hand if you know someone like this. Go ahead right now in the comments. Raise your hand. There's no judgment here because we probably know someone or we've been someone who thinks we are right. Why? Because being right is our right. That's how a fool lives. That's how a fool lives. We recently got back from a trip to Colorado, and we love Colorado, being able to be outside and exploring without feeling like we're going to melt in the heat because the weather is always so nice up there. We spend most of our days outside when we're in Colorado, and that's how it was this trip. We were hiking and exploring, and Nick loves to fish. He spent so much time fishing, never caught anything, but he spent all of our time up there fishing while we explored and hiked. And my kids, they love to find rocks. And in turn, they want to bring back the 40 tons of rocks that they found, and then I have to break their hearts and tell them they can only bring a few. But still, they love to hunt and search for rocks and treasures. And of course, they are drawn to shiny, sparkly rocks because they think they found something worth something. There is not an adventure that goes by where I don't hear the words, "Mom, look, I found gold. I think it's real." But in reality, it's not. They think they found gold, but it's just fool's gold. Fool's gold, not the real thing. Here's the problem with thinking it's real. Here's the problem with thinking that we know better. It will cost us. Thinking we know better, wanting to be right, it will cost us relationships. It will cost us influence. It will cost us. Do we want to be right and die on the hill of our rightness? Or do we follow Jesus and live with wisdom and want to point people to the only right thing in our world? And that's Him and His way. Proverbs 16:2, people may be pure in their own eyes, but the Lord examines their motives. We're all in love with our own opinions. We think we know the way, but it's God. It's the Holy Spirit in us, testing us and examining our hearts, seeking to lead us. That verse, it keeps going in verse 3. Commit your actions to the Lord and your plans will succeed. Before you do anything, before you make a decision, before you post on Facebook, before you decide to rant against that person, before you vent in anger, before you get offended, before you buy the boat, before you do anything, put your trust in God and not in yourself, not in your opinions, not in your ideas. And then the plans that you make, the words that you talk, the way that you go will not be ones of foolishness, but ones that succeed, ones that hold wisdom. Paul, he's a follower of Christ and he wrote a lot of the New Testament. He says the same thing about living foolishly and following God. In Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 through 18, Paul says, "So be careful how you live. Don't live like fools, but like those who are wise. Make the most of every opportunity in these evil days." I think it's interesting that Paul called those days evil. And today, these days are still evil, and it takes work to be wise instead of foolish. He continues, "Don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants you to do. Don't be drunk with wine, because it'll ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit." Paul says, "Don't be a fool. Walk carefully. Slow down. Think about how you speak. Think about how you act. Fools go wherever they want to go, say whatever they want to say, do whatever they want to do, but don't be like that. Be wise. Understand the will of God and be filled with His Spirit. Let His Spirit guide you and teach you and correct you. Let Him change your opinions and change your thought patterns and change your ways. Let Him give you wisdom so that you don't live like a fool." I want you to take a moment and think about your life. Filter it through living like a fool. Fools refuse criticism, are impulsive, and think they know better. Think about your friendships. Who is the they in your life? Who's surrounding you? Are they fools or do they seek wisdom? Are they the right they? Are they seeking God and seeking to be encouraging? Do they think they know it all or live with humility? Do your relationships look wise or foolish? Living like a fool or living like the wise? Think about your interactions with others. Think about your social media interactions. Are you seeking to be right or are you seeking for God to be known? His simple commands are to love Him and to love others. Is that reflected in how you interact with others? The others on your Facebook page and the others in your home. The others in the grocery store and the others in your office space. Are your interactions wise or foolish? Are you living like a fool or living like the wise? Think about your work. Schoolwork, yard work, classwork, housework, your 8-to-5 job work. Are you working as if working to please God? Are you putting forth effort? Or are you just coasting? Is it wise or foolish? Think about your media choices, entertainment choices, wise or foolish. Think about your marriage, your dating relationships. Is it modeled after wisdom? Or are you living like a fool? Where has God asked you to be wise and you said no? Well, how can you start living in wisdom today? Proverbs 3:5-6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and do not depend on your own understanding. Seek His will in all you do and He will show you which path to take." In the land before now, in the times before COVID, I used to get up early and go to the gym. I wanted to be one of the first ones there so I could get there and get home. And when I got up that early, it was dark outside, like pitch dark. We lived just outside of town, and it was very dark when I would walk out of the house and out to the car. And since I lived out, what we say, out in the boonies, I didn't want to get bit by a snake, because they are out there, or trip over something in the yard, so I would turn the flashlight on my phone. I use the flashlight on my phone. Have you ever done that, where you've used the light to see where you're going or to look for something? I mean, we all do it. I would turn on my flashlight, but then I would forget to turn off the screen. I would leave the screen on and have my flashlight on and try to make my way out to the car. And the brightness from the backlit screen would actually prevent me from seeing where the flashlight was leading me. The screen interfered with the flashlight beam, and I couldn't focus on where I wanted to go until I turned off the screen and just used the flashlight. Listen, you can't have your light and His light guiding you. You can't have your will and His will. You can't have your understanding of things and God's understanding of things. It doesn't work that way. Proverbs 3 says, lean not on your own understanding. That's living like a fool. Living like the wise is choosing his way, his will, his understanding, and allowing him to guide and lead you. A few verses later in that same chapter, it says this, the wise inherit honor and the fools get only shame. Because ultimately, living like a fool brings shame. Living dependent on your own understanding, it leads to shame. But shame doesn't have to be your legacy. It doesn't have to be your inheritance. None of us want to live like fools. We don't want shame to be our legacy. And the answer is Jesus. Jesus came so that honor becomes your inheritance. Jesus came to take your shame and to take your foolishness. We can read Proverbs and we realize all of the ways we've messed up, blown it, lived like a fool. And we can get stuck there in that foolishness, in our mistakes. Or if we push through the pain of our mistakes, we can hear the whisper of hope. We hear Jesus say, shame isn't your legacy. Listen to me. Learn wisdom. Let's try again. Lean on me, not on your own understanding. Honor will be your inheritance because walking with him leads to living like the wise and living with wisdom and not living like a fool. Let's pray. God, I thank you so much for the gift of your word that we don't have to live like fools. Thank you for loving us even when we do. Today, lead us in wisdom. Show us where we've gone off track. Show us where we need to grow and help us to walk in obedience towards you. Today, as you listened, maybe you felt a nudge that there's been more foolishness in your life than wisdom. You've been reminded of mistakes in your past. You feel like you've depended on your own ideas and your own understanding to make it in life. But the first step for you would be to choose to follow Jesus, to allow him to lead you. And if that's you, I want to invite you to say this prayer after me. Dear Jesus, I am a sinner. I have lived foolishly. And I need you. Thank you for dying for me. Please forgive me. I want to follow your way. And today, I trust you fully with my life. Thank you for loving me. In your life-giving, life-changing name, I pray. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer today, we want to know. We want to celebrate this important decision that you have made. You can let us know by texting your name plus the word commit to 254-485-2114. We have some resources that we'd love to give you as you begin to walk with Jesus, as you begin to walk with wisdom. Or you can click the link commit in the comment section of this video. So text your name and to the number on the screen or click the link and let us know about the decision that you made. We are so excited for you. Thank you so much for joining us today. And here's to learning to live like the wise instead of living like a fool.